last night's startling discovery. There are more adjectives for drunkenness than there are Inuit words for snow. And I'm not just talking about being intoxicated or inebriated or even blotto, blasted, or bombed. There are well over 3,000 descriptors. Just looking at the list makes me feel tipsy. What's more interesting, though, is the difference between the words used for men and women, young and old, bodily and behavioral effects, and how expressions vary across cultures and languages to reveal both positive and negative views. This is exactly what you're going to discover in this episode of the Unreserved Wine Talk podcast. Do you have a thirst to learn about wine? Do you love stories about wonderfully obsessive people, hauntingly beautiful places, and amusingly awkward social situations? Well, that's the blend here on the Unreserved Wine Talk podcast. I'm your host, Natalie McLean, and each week I share with you unfiltered conversations with celebrities in the wine world, as well as confessions from my own tipsy journey as I write my third book on this subject. I'm so glad you're here. Now pass me that bottle, please, and let's get started. Welcome to episode 110. So, last night's startling discovery. There are more adjectives for drunkenness than there are Inuit words for snow. And I'm not just talking about being intoxicated or inebriated or even blotto, blasted, or bombed. There are well over 3,000 descriptors. Just looking at the list makes me feel tipsy. What's more interesting, though, is the difference between the words used for men and women, young and old, bodily and behavioral effects, and how expressions vary across cultures and languages to reveal both positive and negative views. This is exactly what you're going to discover in this episode of the Unreserved Wine Talk podcast. Now, I'm not encouraging oversampling, but I find the language around it fascinating and sometimes humorous. I mean, just look at the titles of my two books, Red, White, and Drunk All Over, A Wine-Soaked Journey from Grape to Glass, and Unquenchable, A Tipsy Search for the World's Best Bargain Bottles. However, I do take alcoholism quite seriously. As I've mentioned previously on this podcast, my father was an alcoholic. The disease runs in my family on both sides, but so too does a love of language and learning. As Brendan Behan, a writer at the New Yorker magazine, said, quote, "I'm a drinker with a writing problem," end quote. In the show notes, you'll find a full transcript of this podcast, where you can find me on both Instagram and Facebook Live every second Wednesday at 7 p.m., and how you can join me in a free online wine and food pairing class. That's all in the show notes at nataliemclean.com/110. In the new year, I'll be hosting virtual wine and chocolate pairing classes for several corporate groups and other organizations, as it has a great tie-in with Valentine's Day, and attendees can participate at home with their loved ones. I'll also be hosting wine and cheese tastings. So if you're interested in my doing this for your group, please email me at natalie@nataliemclean.com. You'll also find my contact in the show notes. Okay, on with the show. So I had lots of help researching this subject for friends who came up with a bandwagon of terms. And contrary to what they suggested, simply being a wine writer of Scottish-Irish descent does not make me an automatic authority. First, let's look at the cooking and baking category. Words that describe the effect of drink on our internal organs as though they're pot roasts. Stewed, boiled, brewed, smoked, sauced, soaked, basted, boiled, and fried. Or as though they're preserves. Jarred, canned, corked, pickled, juiced, and minced. Or finally, as pastries, were baked, pie-eyed, buttered, or toasted. Soused, for example, comes from the 17th century English, originally meaning to marinate, which is closely related to sozzled, which means made moist. So to be precise, we get sozzled before we get soused. Other adjectives observe our behavior. Drunks are childish, a bag of toys, or crazy. They're gone, gonzo, knackered, loopy, out of it, scattered, snappered, zoned, zonker, zombied, cockeyed, comatose, or just plain stupid. And yet to use the definition of any one of those words sounds really weird, as in, I'm going to drink myself into a low level of intelligence tonight. Drinking brings out our animal nature too, making us drunk as a skunk, weasel-eyed, ratted, zooed, ripped as a newt, boiled as an owl, howling, hog-whimpering, or roaring drunk. Those of us who drank too much at college dorm parties may recall the extreme adjectives, even murder metaphors, of our youth. And indeed, we probably did kill off parts of our brains and livers. They were usually grouped by method, like a sharp instrument. So we were half cut, ripped, let her rip, screwed. Blunt instrument, hammered, smashed, whammed, slammed, stoned, or ossified. Poison, polluted, gas, trashed. Electrocution, wired, buzzed, zapped, blistered. Hanging, so we tied one on, looped, strung out, twisted. And car accident, not firing on all cylinders, well-oiled, shellacked, lubricated, pumped up, totaled, mashed, or wrecked. Then there was the injury or death from no apparent cause. We were done in, ruined, obliterated, decimated, paralytic, legless, blind drunk, or dead drunk. From fighting, we get thrashed, lashed, wasted, or clobbered. Spifflicated, or given a thorough thrashing and overcome completely, comes from the 18th century English combination of stifle and suffocate. In 1818, Sir Thomas More wrote, quote, "Alas, alas, our ruins fated, all done up and spifflicated," end quote. Now that we've matured, most of us prefer to get mellow rather than mangled, enjoying that drowsy, sunlit windowsill feeling. The adjectives, too, are more genteel. Sociable, feeling no pain, woozy, have a glow on, over-refreshed, euphoric, or afflicted. The adjectives to describe women are more euphemized than men. We're tipsy, in our cups, tiddly, or whiffled, as though we've been tippling with Daisy Buchanan from The Great Gatsby. But real men get tight, lagered, or liquored up. Celebrities are never more than, quote, tired and emotional, unquote, presumably needing a rest at a rustic Betty Ford resort. But working class adjectives sound as though we're doing home renovations or landscaping. We're plastered, pasted, lamped, lit, well irrigated, hosed, or plowed. Some expressions are easily understood. Wearing your wobbly boots, having a close look at the footpath, under the table, full of loudmouth soap, or predicting earthquakes. But others seem to come from another time. Three sheets to the wind is a 19th century naval phrase. Sheets are what landlubbers like me would call ropes, and they control the sails. So three sheets to the wind means that those ropes weren't tied down, but left flapping, and hence to the wind. To be half in the bag, nearly drunk, or in the bag, fully drunk, may either be a shortened version of the breathalyzer bag or simply a bag holding and concealing the booze. Going on a bender referred to the crooked way a drunk walks. Going on a jag means drinking to excess, but a jag is also used for other types of emotional breakdowns, such as a crying jag. Drunk as blazes is a corruption of the 1860 drunk as blaziers after the participants in a feast in honor of St. Blaise. But perhaps more revealing is to look across cultures and languages. My French-speaking friends insist that there aren't nearly as many words for drunk in their own language because in their culture, they grew up with alcohol as something to be enjoyed in moderation rather than as forbidden. Nevertheless, the French say, Il est paqueté. Literally, he's parceled up or bagged. Or bourré, stuffed or loaded. Then there's si ma mère m'avait donné du lait comme ça, je serais encore avec elle. If my mother had given me milk like this, I'd still be with her. And il boirait la mer et les poissons. He would drink the whole ocean along with the fish. Another expression must be accompanied by the appropriate gesture. Someone says, je suis complètement, I am full, or plein comme un œuf, full like an egg, then makes a fist, brings the thumb and forefinger to his nose, and makes an unscrewing motion. In Spanish, they talk about catching a hake or a sigla, large crayfish, in an ocean of fish. A borracho is a drunk. The Japanese say they're getting yod, having one too many, or chidoriashi, drunks who walk like the bird called chidori, which scampers right and left but never in a straight line. In Germany, they say ich bin blau, I am blue, or ich habe einen Schwips, which means I have a Schwips, both onomatopoeic, drunken speech is often bubbly, as well as related to the German word for hiccup. Schickered, which conveniently rhymes with liquored, is Australian slang for getting intoxicated. It comes from the early 20th century Yiddish word shiker, or drunk. And some folks use Adrian Quist, the Australian tennis champ from the 1960s, because it rhymes with I'm pissed, which also brings to mind the entire scabrous family of adjectives, stinko, shit-faced, and crapulous. Latin doesn't give us just in vino veritas, in wine the truth, as in a few glasses will get anyone talking freely, but also plures crapula quam gladius, drunkenness kills more than the sword. In Austria, they say, hat zun tief in glas gegut. He looked too deeply into his glass. In Russia, let's have a drink, even if it's just Paulina Ivanova. Paulina Ivanova is a brand of furniture polish consumed by drunks for its alcohol content. Others use the phrase to mean a simple drink, nothing fancy. A friend's late grandfather used to own a pub in Ireland, and according to him, his grandfather was the quintessential Irish publican, the local moneylender, church usher, political organizer, and booze hound. Every couple of months, he'd hire a barkeeper for 3 to 4 days and announce that he was going on his holidays. The journey entailed him wobbling over to the other side of the bar and staying there for the duration. While on these holidays, none of the regulars would talk to him about money, business, or politics. The phrase became part of the local vernacular, and holidays were taken every couple of months for 60 glorious years. Another story says that in Dublin pubs, the bartender would try to calm everyone down by telling them to mind their P's and Q's. P stood for pint and Q for quart. Others claim that regulars would admonish the barman with those words to make sure he tallied their bill correctly and didn't charge them for a quart when they had only drank a pint. Still yet another origin story says this advice was to printers' apprentices to avoid confusing the backward-facing metal type lowercase p's and q's, or the same advice given to children who are learning to write. Regardless, they all ended up at the pub after a long day, except the children, of course. And apparently, there used to be whistles at the top of beer mugs, and when you wanted a refill, you'd blow your whistle or wet your whistle. The English language is a glorious living thing, if the number of new words to describe modern-day drunkenness is any indication. There's Merle Haggard, after the king of mournful country western drinking songs, and Moulin Rouge from the musical movie about booze-soaked bohemian Paris in 1900. The high-tech crowd gives us rendered and pixelated. In Western Canada, they talk about being cambled or inclined to have one too many, after the drinking exploits of the former premiers of British Columbia, Gordon Campbell, and Alberta, Ralph Klein. The range of words we use to describe excessive drinking is unmatched by those for overeating, overexercising, or even overcopulating. Perhaps that's because getting loaded hits our sensory circuits like nothing else. not only are we full of alcohol, but we're also full of the loudest laughter, the biggest gestures, the tenderest sympathies, the grandest schemes, and the blackest rages. And the next morning, the deepest regrets. Yet when most of us are obliviated, we've lost the nuances of diction and etymology to describe how we're feeling, or we're in denial. As in, I'm not affluenced by alcohol at all. I hope you enjoyed this episode. In the show notes, you'll find the full transcript of this podcast, where you can find me on both Instagram and Facebook Live video every second Wednesday at 7 p.m., and how you can join me in a free online wine and food pairing class. That's all in the show notes at nataliemclain.com/110. If you're interested in my hosting a wine and cheese or wine and chocolate tasting for your group, please email me at natalie@nataliemclain.com. You can also find my contact in the show notes. You won't want to miss next week when I'm chatting with Karen King about delicious ice wine cocktails. She joins me from the Ice House Winery in Niagara. In the meantime, if you missed episode 2, go back and take a listen. I talk about the buzz of wine specifically and its allure and why it's almost taboo in wine writing. I'll share a short clip with you now to whet your appetite. This was the alarming headline in a recent health study. Quote, "No amount of alcohol is safe," unquote. What? It was published in The Lancet, one of the oldest and most prestigious medical journals in the world. My first thought was, no, say it ain't so. My next thought was, I need to ask my doctor friends about this. Turns out that the study has several flaws. What a relief. It's been proven in the past that moderate drinkers who have one glass of wine a day live longer than those who don't drink at all. There was also criticism published in the medical community about the alarmist headline and how the numbers and statistics were presented. The best advice I got? Stress is a bigger concern when it comes to both longevity and heart disease, the biggest killer. I was told, relax, drink moderately, and try not to stress out about this study, Nat. If you liked this episode, please tell one friend about it this week, especially someone you know who'd be interested in the fuzzy vine-acular of alcohol. Thank you for taking the time to join me here. I hope something great is in your glass this week. Perhaps a wine that you sip slowly, rather than guzzle, gulp, or goggle it down. You don't want to miss one juicy episode of this podcast, especially the secret, full-bodied bonus episodes that I don't announce on social media. So subscribe for free now at nataliemclain.com/subscribe. Meet me here next week. Cheers.